So it's nice to see all of you here. Isn't it nice to be together? And one nice thing about these retreats is you all come from different places, different parts of the world, and get together and get to know each other, develop relationship, and feel happy. So that's what Srila Prabhupada, that's the good fortune, that's the wonderful arrangement that Srila Prabhupada made for us to become one family. And Srila Prabhupada built a house where the whole world can live. And that house is ISKCON. And on our part, let's just take full advantage of it. We are here to relish each other's association, and we are here to enrich ourselves with transcendental knowledge. And this knowledge is actually the awareness of our ancestors. In Bhagavatam, the personalities that we are getting to hear about, they are our ancestors. We belong to this family, and this is the family of Krishna devotees. We all are related to each other with Krishna in the center. And that is the wonderful family that we belong to. And although we may be coming from different backgrounds, different social, political, religious backgrounds, but here we all become related to each other. So that is the wonderful world of Hare Krishna. Once I gave a seminar on our spiritual heritage. In that I just pointed out that this is our heritage, starting from Lord Brahma. And in this line, we have so many wonderful personalities. In this line, we have great kings, great demigods, great monarchs, sometimes even great demons. Like today, we'll discuss about Vritrasura. But first, I'll discuss about Ajamil. A wonderful episode. Ajamil was a brahmana in a province called Kannakubja, which is today's Kannauj. Is there anyone from Kannauj? It's in northern part of India. It's a part of Uttar Pradesh now. The Sanskrit name for that place was Konnakubja. And there was a brahmana. He was a very wonderful boy. He was trained up by his father in a very wonderful way. He studied scriptures very diligently. He performed the Brahminical rituals very diligently. He was assisting his father in his spiritual activities. This is how, in Vedic culture, the children used to grow up by being trained by the parents. Parents and spiritual masters. Sometimes people criticize the varnashram system. In today's world, varnashram system has become branded as caste system. That someone is born in a certain family, and he is considered to belong to that caste. A brahmana's son becomes a brahmana. In the Vedic time, that was actually the culture. A brahmana's son used to become a brahmana. A kshatriya's son used to become a kshatriya. But of course, the consideration was not the birth. The main consideration was qualification. And qualification actually did matter in being, I mean, the birth did matter to develop the qualification. For example, a brahmana's son, from his childhood, he used to be with his father, he used to assist his father, and as a result of that, he used to be trained up as a brahmana. Similarly, a warrior's son, what a warrior's son would do? He would be with his father. He would be in the same surrounding where all others are warriors. So he would be trained up to be a warrior. From his childhood, he would grow up with weapons. He would grow up learning how to use those weapons. And in a similar way, a potter's son also from his childhood would learn how to make pots. Earthen pots. Like he would see his father is doing that, his uncle doing that, and he would help his father, he would help his uncle. And he'd start probably with, bacha thora mitti lao, bring the clay, and then say, mix the clay. So from his childhood, he would learn to bring the clay, mix the clay, and then when he'd grow up a little more, then the father would probably give him some task. The father is making big pots and he'll be asked to make a small pot. He would play this way. Then the father will say, okay, help me. Just turn the wheel. The potter's wheel, it turns and that's how he shapes it. And then he will say, okay, hold it like this. And this is how a potter's son would learn how to make pots. So this is how in the Vedic time, the birth did matter. Birth did help to develop the qualities. But that's not the case anymore in this age. In this age, no one is being trained up by father or uncle or elder brother and so forth. In this age, everyone is going to school. No connection with the family line. Only thing that they maintain, the family thing, I've noticed, are the Vaishyas, the business people. I mean, I remember, like, most of my business people friends from business families, they studied commerce. And the commerce section was in the morning. So they would go to college in the morning, commerce, and then after the college, they would go to their father's business. And this is how they would trained up. They would get trained up to, and in a way we can see only the Vaishyas, some Vaishya families are maintaining that, and they do. Like when I was young, no Vaishya family, boys, will take up a job. They'll never take up a job. Now things are also changing, like because the jobs they consider to be more prestigious. Although they have to be work like a slave, but they dress up nicely, they have nice facilities, car and fancy houses provided by them and nice bonus. But if they consider, then as a Vaishya, even a small shopkeeper, he would earn more money. In business, you make more money than you get in your salary. So anyway, so the point that I was making, that Ajamil, like any other Brahmana boy, was trained up by his father to become a Brahmana. And he was a very nice boy, qualified. He was endowed with wonderful Brahminical qualities. So one day his father sent him to the forest to bring some fruits and flowers and wood. Mainly wood. And when he was returning home from the forest, he saw one man and woman there indulging in lusty activities. And as the natural propensity is, he was an innocent young boy, not a young boy, innocent, I mean, chaste young man. He was not any boy anymore. He was even married at that time. But just that act attracted him so much. Seeing this man and woman indulging in this activity. So he somehow got fascinated by that woman. And he fell in love with her. And he left his chaste wife and started to spend his time with this woman. So this is how strong Maya's influence is. First thing he did, he stole the money that his father had saved in order to please that woman. She was a prostitute, all she wanted is money. So he started to steal the money from his father. Father's savings were stolen by him. And then gradually he started to steal. Then he started to rob. And in course of his stealing and robbing, he started to kill people. And in this way, Ajamil started to become degraded. He started to drink. And when one starts to drink, he loses his consciousness, he loses his sanity. And it is a steady decline of his character. And then, in course of time, Ajamil got 10 children from this woman, this prostitute woman. And he was old, but his youngest son was quite young, and he was very fond of his youngest son. And he named him Narayan. And he was very attached to his youngest son. He always used to keep him with him. And if he was away, he would be very emotional and find out where he was. And in this way, he developed a deep, deep attachment for his youngest son, Narayan. And now Ajamil is going to die. His death came. Yesterday we discussed about Puranjana's story, what naturally happens. Time, the daughter of time, embraces you, embraces one, and he loses all his vitality. Old age, jada. And along with that comes prajhara, high fever, various kinds of disease causing this fever. And then finally, one has to leave his body. Those who are sinful, they don't want to leave their bodies. Sinful people, because they don't have any higher knowledge, they think they lead a life centered around their body consciousness. Therefore, when the time comes from leaving the body, they don't want to leave that body because they don't have any information about the other world. They don't have any information that they are going to get another body. So there is no harm, no loss in losing the old dilapidated body when he knows that there is a prospect of getting a new body. So that is why sinful people naturally become attached to their body, and it becomes very, very difficult for them to die. It becomes very difficult for them to leave their body. That is why Jamaraj sends his dutas, his assistants, his messengers. And they come and pull out that personality. That personality in the sense, from the gross body, he pulls out the subtle body. They pull out the subtle body. The gross body dies, but subtle body never dies. So subtle body is pulled out, and they don't want to. They're seeing that they're losing their body. So three Jamadutas came to take Ajamil out of his body. The Jamadutas have a noose that they put around the neck. I mean, the subtle body also has a neck. Like to understand what the subtle body is like, we have to remember how we feel in a dream. In a dream, when something you feel, see that something is happening to you, does it happen to you? At the time of dream, do you think that it is a dream? Or at the time of dream, you think it is a dream? I mean, it is real. In your dream, when you see that you have become a millionaire, you have become a king, do you feel that it is that you have become a king? Yes. Because the only so let me give another example. In a dream, when you see that you are being attacked by a tiger or a snake, how do you feel? Do you feel, oh, after all, it's a dream? Do you feel that way? Or you feel afraid and you scream? So it's a matter of where your consciousness is. The only thing is that when we dream, we also have our gross body. So from dream state, we wake up to our gross body, conscious state. And then the dream disappears. But when you don't have any more gross body, then what happens? Is there any possibility of waking up from the dream? No. The dream continues on and on and on. You dwell at that time in your subtle platform, in your subtle body. So the subtle body is now being pulled out. Ajamil was afraid seeing this vicious looking Jamadutas. They put the noose around his neck and started to pull out. Ajamil was screaming. And when they scream, when he was hesitated, when he was not willing to get out of the body, they have their whips. They hit you with the whips. And he screams. So when Ajamil was in that state, just being dragged out of his gross body, his spirit soul in the subtle body is being dragged out, then Ajamil, due to his attachment to his youngest son, called out to him. Now he's feeling extreme pain that he is being separated from his son. So this is how at the time of death, we will think of where our deepest attachment is. Where was Ajamil's deepest attachment? His son. He was feeling the pain of becoming separated from his son. So he called out, Narayan, Narayan. And immediately, four Vishnu Dutas appeared there. They had four hands, that conch and lotus and mess and disc in their four hands. And they immediately told those Jamadutas, leave him alone. The Jamadutas said, look, he is an extremely sinful person. And he is to be taken to Jamaraj for judgment. Now, why are you preventing us? Then they smiled at them, laughed at them. They said that these people, they're talking about dharma and don't have any knowledge about dharma. Sinful reactions, they must be punished. That is the dharmic code. They have to be taken to Jamaraj. And so they said that you don't have any knowledge about dharma. One is sinful and he should be punished. Only as long as he doesn't surrender to the Supreme Lord. The moment one surrenders to the Supreme Lord, even unconsciously, even if one chants the holy name of the Lord unconsciously or jokingly, or being in some sort of distressful condition, without being aware of the glory of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, still he becomes free from all his sinful reactions. So don't you know that this person chanted the name of Narayan? So he has chanted the holy name of the Lord. So just because of the chanting of the holy name of the Lord, all his sinful reactions have been immediately burnt out. Just as a log with the contact of fire gets burnt into ashes, nothing is left of the log. That's what happens to sinful reactions when one chants the holy name of the Lord. So in this way, these Jamaduta, the Vishnu Dutas, instructed the Jamadutas. And Ajamil was just seeing that. And then finally Jamadutas left that place quite disappointed that their mission has been unsuccessful. So they just left. And in the meantime, Ajamil saw the benefit of chanting of the holy name of the Lord. He saw the benefit of surrendering to the Supreme Personality of the Lord. Like he realized that he had been so sinful. The whole past life flashed across his mind. So many people he caused so much distress to. So many people he killed. So many families he just plundered. And all those sinful reactions were actually about to cause him a terrible situation in the hell, Naraka. but just by accidental chanting. Accidental chanting of the name of Narayan. He didn't mean Narayan. He called his son. It was not actually chanting the holy name. It was Nam Abhash. Some resemblance to the holy name. Not the holy name, just some resemblance to the holy name. The alphabetical pronunciation of the holy name. Relieved him from all his sinful reactions. So he offered his obeisances to the Vishnu Dutas. And then he went to Haridwar on the foothills of the Himalayas, on the bank of the Ganges. And there Ajamil started to perform his spiritual activities. That means chanting the holy name of the Lord, worshipping the Lord, offering service to the Lord. Very diligently he started to practice a spiritual life. And as a result of that, Ajamil got attachment to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And now, this is how Ajamil got the second chance. He got the second chance and he got the opportunity to get out of this material nature and go back. Eventually, the chariot came from the spiritual sky to take Ajamil to Vaikuntha. Now in the meantime, when the Jamadutas were disappointed in this way, in their mission, they went back to Jamraj and announced, "My Lord, for the first time in our life, we had been unsuccessful. So far, all the sinful people, we dragged them to you for judgment. Your noose and these whips never failed. It's a long way to come from planet to Jamalaya. But although they did not want to come, we brought them, dragged them here. This time we failed. Four personalities appeared. They were so brilliant. They had four arms. And in their four, their complexion was like a blue sapphire, bright blue sapphire. They had conch, lotus, mess and disc in their hands. And they were such beautiful looking personalities. They were wearing bright silk garments. And when we are bringing Ajamil out of his body, dragging him out of his body, then all of a sudden these people appeared and stopped us from bringing Ajamil to you. What actually happened, my Lord? So the Jamadutas asked Jamraj. Then Jamraj said, "Yes, they are Vishnu Dutas. They patrol around everywhere to protect the devotees. And whenever they see that a devotee is in danger, they immediately appear there and protect the rescue that devotee. And who is a devotee? Who chants the holy name of the Lord. Who is a devotee? Who wears tilak on his forehead. Who is a devotee? Who wears kantimala on his neck. Who is a devotee? Who has a sikha in his forehead and the back of his head. Back of his head. Even though if a person doesn't wear these devotional symbols, like tilak, kantimala, and sikha, but if one has the holy name in his vibrating in his mouth, in his tongue, irrespective of his situation, he is a devotee. So this Ajamil, no matter how sinful he was, as soon as he chanted the holy name of the Lord, these Vishnudutas, they felt responsible to come to his rescue. And that's what happened. Ajamil chanted the holy name. Although this chanting of the holy name was in Namabhar stage, unconsciously, due to not really indicating the Lord, he chanted. He chanted the name addressing his son. Although it was not a pure name of the Lord. It was just an accidental chanting of the name of the Lord for another purpose. It's called helaya, neglectfully, jokingly, or being in distress. If one chants this name, becomes free from all sinful reactions. That's the potency of the holy name. And that is what Haridas Thakur actually told when he was giving his discourse in the house of Raghunath Das Goswami's father. He said, Ek Krishna name jato pap hare, kono papir shaddha nai tato pap kare. And he also quoted, which means the one name of the Lord, the amount of sin that one name of the Lord can destroy, no sinner has the ability to commit that kind of sin, that much sin. See? No sinner has the ability to commit so much sin that one name of the Lord cannot destroy. And Haridas Thakur actually told him, mentioned, Koti janme brahma gyane jei mukti noy, shudhumatra namabhashe shei mukti hoy. The liberation that is not achieved by acquiring Brahman realization for millions of lifetimes. The liberation that one cannot achieve by acquiring Brahma-gyan, spiritual transcendental knowledge of Brahma-gyan, Brahman, for millions of lifetimes. Koti, one koti means 10 millions. The liberation that one cannot achieve through millions of lifetimes by acquiring Brahma-gyan, just in Namabhash one receives that liberation. Not pure chanting, just Namabhash. And Ajamil's story, Ajamil's anecdote is an example for that. Ajamil did not chant the name of Narayan being aware of Narayan. He chanted addressing his son. It is a Namabhash, not Nam, but Nam Abhash, some sort of shadow of the name, reflection of the name. But he became free from all his sinful reactions. So Jamraj actually advised them, and Jamraj told them that don't go near those people. Those who chant the holy name of the Lord, don't go near them. They are beyond your jurisdiction. Just offer obeisances to them from a distance and leave that place. So this is how Jamraj advised. And then Jamraj told them, this knowledge is not this knowledge is not known to everyone. Only some real personalities know this knowledge. There are 12 of us who have this knowledge. Who are those 12 personalities? Swayambhu, Lord Brahma, Narada, Narad Muni, Shambhu, Lord Shiva, Swayambhur, Narada, Shambhu, Prahlad Maharaj, Janak Maharaj, Prahlad, Janaka, Bhishma, four Kumar, Kapila Dev, four Kumaras, Manu, Swayambhur, Narada, Shambhu, Kumara, Kapila, Manu, Prahlad, Janaka, Bhishma, Vaiyashaki, Sukadev Goswami, Bali Maharaj, a demon, but he is a Mahajan, by and me. So these are the 12 personalities. So they have this knowledge. Otherwise, this knowledge is not available. Not that in those who are expert in Vedic wisdom, they don't know that. They perform all kinds of activities, spiritual activities, following the Vedas, Karmakanda section, Gyanakanda section, but they don't have this knowledge. Now these 12 rare personalities, 12 Mahajans had this knowledge. But today in this assembly, how many of you are here? About 160 of you. Now do you have this knowledge? Who created this good fortune for you all, which was otherwise so rare? Srila Prabhupada. So this is the causeless mercy of Srila Prabhupada. So today this knowledge has become so widely available. Why? By this divine arrangement of Srila Prabhupada, which was actually inaugurated by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. This knowledge otherwise was not available at all. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came and made it available. He is the one who made everyone aware of the glory of the holy name. So now you understand why it is so important to chant the holy name and what kind of good fortune this chanting of the holy name creates. So are you going to diligently chant your 16 rounds every day? Yes, please do that. Isn't it a wonderful anecdote? So that's what I meant actually. In Bhagavatam, we are hearing stories, but from the stories we are getting such a wealth of wisdom, such wealth of knowledge. So this was the Ajamil, Upakhan, Ajamil story. And then we go to another very wonderful personality. Next coming, the story of Chitraketu. Another very wonderful anecdote. As I was saying, not only the stories are exciting to hear, but they're steeped with such wisdom. Do you think it was nice that we selected this topic? I feel happy because I'm seeing that no one is falling asleep. Although it is said that Nidra Devi finds a suitable place where Bhagavad Katha goes on. But I am feeling happy that दिस भागवत कथा, इन दिस भागवत कथा इवन निद्रा देवी इज वाइड अवेक एंड लिसनिंग. Chitraketu was a king in a state, in a country called Surasena. He was a king of that country. And Chitraketu was an extremely powerful person. But unfortunately, Chitraketu didn't have any children. Now just consider, he has this enormous wealth. He is a king. But he doesn't have anyone to succeed him. Naturally, for a rich person, for a wealthy person, that becomes a big consideration. What's going to happen to my wealth when I die? And Chitraketu, mind you, those days, they used to live for a long, long time. And they used to be extremely powerful. And Chitraketu had 10,000 wives. Now, again, should he believe Srimad Bhagavatam? These are the challenges. Like, sometimes the statements of Bhagavatam can be quite bewildering and unbelievable. Like 10,000. Okay, Krishna we can understand. He is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He had 16,000 wives. I mean, for the Supreme Personality of Godhead, we can accept that. But an ordinary mortal, a human being. But the thing is, these are also the challenges. Believe it? Do you believe in Bhagavatam? Yes, that is how we should approach Srimad Bhagavatam. Sometimes it is beyond us, we can understand, okay. I don't understand, let's carry on. How he could have 10,000 wives. Unfortunately, still he didn't have a son. Probably what he was doing, he was getting married again and again and again and again, hoping that some wife would give him a son. But still he did not get it. So one day Angira Rishi came to him again. Who is Angira Rishi? Did I mention that in one of the earlier classes? Maybe I did not. Angira is the son of Brahma. This part of the creation aspect, although I intended to speak about, but I did not. Like the creation begins in this way. Brahma created four sons, the four Kumaras. Sanak, Sanatan, Sanandan, and Sanat Kumar. The Brahma's first four sons. And what was Brahma's business? Do you remember why Brahma came to this universe? Why Brahma came to this material nature? His business was to fill up the universe which was empty with living entities. So that was Brahma's business. Fill up with living entities means to be active in the living and active in this material nature. Living entities has to have bodies, right? Material bodies. So Brahma started to award material bodies to different living entities and made arrangements to fill up the universe with living entities in this way. So Brahma then created, he thought that I have to fill up, so let me create some individuals. So who came as first offsprings of Brahma? friend, they came from Brahma's mind. See how powerful Brahma is, that from his mind he could award bodies to living entities. Yes, briefly I discussed that the other day. So Brahma created first four sons from his mind. They are known as four Kumaras. And when Brahma told them to help him in his mission, that is to fill up the universe with living entities, that means procreate, create children, they said, "Sorry, sir. we are not going to get involved in these activities." So Brahma became angry, but he controlled his anger. Can you imagine a personality like Brahma, when he can create from his mind, he can create living entities from his mind, procreate living entities from his mind, how powerful his anger can be? His anger would have destroyed these children straight away. So Brahma restrained his anger. But although he restrained his anger, this anger came out from between his eyebrows in the form of Rudra, an incarnation of Lord Shiva. Then Brahma created 10 children from his mind. And they are these sages. Angira is one of them. They are Pulastha, Pulaha, Kratu, Angira, Marichi, Atri, Bhrigu, Vasishtha, Daksha, and Narada. So this is how Brahma started his creation. So Angira is a very, very exalted sage. And one day Angira came to the palace of King Chitraketu. And King Chitraketu was very happy to see him, such an exalted personality. And even the kings, what they would do when a saintly personality would come to his palace, he would offer him the seat, his own seat, his singhasan, his throne. This is how they would receive a saintly personality. And then Angira was asking, "So how is everything with you?" And he mentioned that everything is going on nicely, the kingdom is peaceful, enemies have been subdued, law and order is in perfect order. So these are the general condition that one speaks about. But then Angira asked, "But why do you look so sad then? You have everything in perfect order, then why are you so sad?" So then Angira said, "See, although I have everything, but I don't have a son. I don't have a successor to the throne." So seeing this painful state of King Chitraketu, Angira took pity upon him. And he said, "Okay, I'll perform a yajna, a sacrifice. And as a result of that sacrifice, you will get a son. But this son will naturally be the cause of your happiness, but the son will also be the cause of your sadness, sorrow." So King Chitraketu became very excited. "Oh, finally I'll get a son." And he thought that, okay, yes, every son, sometimes he brings happiness, sometimes he's naughty, and at that time he causes some distress. So he took it like quite lightly. "Oh, fine, after all I'll get a son by your mercy." And Angira Rishi performed a sacrifice. And when the sacrifice was completed, a divine personality came out of the sacrificial fire with a pot of sweet rice. And he offered it to Angira, said, "Give it to your queen and she'll get a child." Another difficult thing to accept. Yes? A child will be born by just taking some sweet rice. But remember, that same thing happened also to King Dasharath. Dasharath did not have any child. So Vasishtha Muni performed this sacrifice, which is called Putreshti, the sacrifice that will get one a son. And what did Dasharath do? Dasharath gave this to his three wives. One half of that sweet rice was given to Kaushalya, and the other half to, he divided into four parts actually. And then one portion he gave to Kaikeyi, and then he gave to Sumitra, and another part he gave to Kaikeyi. So as a result of that, the four sons were born: Ram, Lakshman, Ramchandra from Kaushalya, Lakshman from Sumitra, and two sons came from Kaikeyi, Bharat and Shatrughna. Another story of similar kind is, again, not a story, history. Another such episode was King Brihadrath did not have any son. And once he approached a sage, and the sage, understanding his need or his craving, gave him a fruit. I think it was a mango. And he said, "Give it to your wife and he'll get a son." So he had two wives. So he cut the mango into half and gave the mango to his two wives. And in due course of time, they gave birth to two halves. Two wives gave birth to two halves. And obviously, there was no life. So they threw that two halves of a child away. And at night, there was a witch, a demoness called Jara. They loved to eat flesh, and especially baby's flesh are the delicacy for them. So Jara was very happy to find these two halves of a baby, and playfully she put those two halves together, and they became one, and life came into that body. And who appeared from that? Who was that? Jarasandha. So there are various such anecdotes indicating how it is possible. If modern, so-called modern world can accept that from a fossil, some part of the fossil was taken, and that from that part, a dinosaur came out. So much so that in India, in Calcutta, there's a place called Science City, and the Science City's biggest things are these dinosaurs. They are presenting us dinosaurs as the scientific achievements. So this is how the world is. We can see how much, how bewildered and how much in ignorance these people are. But the real science is the Vedic science. Although things are happening in this way, but the children are not born from the sweet rice or from the mango. Yes, a mango tree comes out from mango. But human children came from the human mother and human father. Living father and living mother. So anyway, so as a result of that, Chitraketu offered this charu or sweet rice that came from the sacrificial fire to his principal wife, Kritaduti. And in due course of time, Kritaduti gave birth to a son. King Chitraketu was so happy, so happy. And as everything else became insignificant to him, his whole attention and his entire obsession was with his son. So he started to spend all his time with this wife who gave him this son, with the son. He stopped going to the court, stopped going to the royal assembly. He stopped neglecting the affairs of the kingdom. He got the ministers and generals to take care of all that. He was completely obsessed with his little son. And as a result of that, the other queens became envious. The king doesn't even look at us nowadays. The king doesn't even consider that we are existing. And it's all because of this child. So get rid of him. So what they did, one day, they made some sweets and added some poison, deadly poison. And called the son, called the child, it's come. There's some sweet for you. So like any other child, oh, some sweet. So he started to eat it. And in no time, he was dead. Remember what Angira Rishi told? That he would be the cause of your happiness, at the same time he'll be the cause of your distress also. Now, at that time, Chitraketu could not recognize the depth of his distress. So, Chitraketu was completely heartbroken. He was fainting. So was the queen, Kritaduti. Sometimes he was just falling on the ground and rolling on the ground, crying piteously. Sometimes he was banging his head against the wall, as if he wanted to give up his body. Now, out of this acute pain, it became totally irrelevant for him to remain alive. So then, at the time, Angira Rishi came again, along with Narad Muni, his brother and friend. So Angira told, I told you, get the son, but he'll be the cause of your distress. And then Angira Rishi just kept on telling him about the futility of this material existence. He kept on crying, please, please, revive this dead son. You are such an exalted personality. You can do that. So then Narad Muni brought the child back to life. He said, "My boy, why are you leaving? Come back. Why are you leaving your father and your mother? Look, due to your separation, how they are feeling. See, due to your separation, they are feeling their existence has become meaningless." So the departed soul came back to the same body. The child sat up and he asked, "Which father and which mother you were talking about?" "I can see galores, multitude of fathers and mothers from my past lives. So which one you are talking about? Now by your mercy that I am going home at the lotus feet of the Lord, please let me go." And then Narad Muni gave instructions, spiritual instructions to King Chitraketu. He said, "Look, what did you learn from this child's words? There are so many fathers, so many mothers, but today you can't even remember them. Similarly, you had so many fathers, so many mothers, so many children in your past lives. Do you remember any one of them? Similarly, in your next life also, you won't remember this child of yours. Today he is so dear to you, but tomorrow you won't even remember him. Even if he comes in front of him, even if he comes in front of you, you won't be able to even recognize him." So then Narad Muni gave him the mantra, saying, he advised him about one's spiritual identity and how to awaken that spiritual identity. Don't remain in this bodily concept of life. This bodily concept of life will simply cause you distress after distress in your existence here. You may get some momentary happiness, but for how long does it last? You were so happy that you got the child. But to the extent you got your happiness, to that extent now you are feeling the pain. So recognize that all this pleasure and pain, happiness and distress is due to this body. So transcend this bodily platform by recognizing that you are a spirit soul. As a spirit soul, you are the part and parcel of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So become situated in that actual identity of yours. I'll give you this mantra. You chant this mantra. And as a result of chanting this mantra, you will develop your relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And then you will transcend the duality of this material nature and you will be able to develop your situation in the absolute platform, which is a platform of endless joy. In that world, there is no stress, no trace of distress or suffering or pain. So he gave the mantra to Chitraketu. And Chitraketu, by chanting and meditating on the mantra, in 7 days he achieved perfection. And as a result of his spiritual perfection, Lord Shankarshan, Balaram appeared in front of him. His bodily complexion was milk white. His form was so beautiful. He was carrying a mess in his hand, and in his shoulder he was carrying a plow. He was wearing a bright blue silk garment. And just the sight of that personality submerged Chitraketu in an ocean of ecstasy, as if he was swimming, as if he was drowning in an ocean of joy. He immediately fell at his feet, offered his obeisances. Shankarshan Dev smiled at him, and he made him the king of the Gandharvas, told him, Chitraketu, now you'll become the king of Gandharvas. And you will be able to travel through the space in a spaceship, and you can go anywhere in that spaceship. So then Chitraketu started to travel in that spaceship. And then while he was flying over Kailash, the abode of Lord Shiva, he saw that Lord Shiva was sitting there with Parvati on his lap, and he was transmitting the transcendental knowledge to a host of saintly personalities, exalted sages and saintly personalities. But Lord Shiva was naked, and on his lap Parvati also was naked. Chitraketu became a little concerned. He laughed. Look, he's imparting spiritual knowledge in this condition with his consort on his lap to the saintly personalities. What kind of behavior is this, and what kind of example it is going to set? In this way, he criticized Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva didn't say anything, but Parvati couldn't tolerate that. Parvati said, you are a wretched soul. You take birth, your behavior is befitting a demon's. So you become a demon. Bhagavatam actually says at that point that Chitraketu could have countercast Parvati. But Chitraketu didn't do that. Chitraketu rather accepted that curse as a benediction. Mother, if that is what you want, I accept it. Yes, now I understand that I made a mistake. My behavior was like that of a demon. So by cursing me that I get a demoniac body, you actually blessed me to be situated in my constitutional position, the position that is befitting me. So, with all humility, I accept your curse. At that point, Lord Shiva told Parvati, Parvati, see, this is the glory of a devotee of the Lord. Like, even though he is cursed, he didn't protest. He didn't even request you to retract that curse. Rather, he accepted. Because for a devotee, going to heaven or hell is the same. For a devotee, what kind of body he gets is not important. That is the glory of the devotion to the Lord. By developing his attachment to the Lord, he transcends all material conditions. And because he transcends all material conditions, he is not affected by any situation whatsoever. In whichever situation he may be in, he is perfectly happy. In this way, Lord Shiva described the glory of a devotee of the Lord. Because he is situated on the spiritual platform, the material condition doesn't affect him at all. So, due to Parvati's curse, now Chitraketu appeared as a demon. He also appeared from a sacrificial fire. He didn't take birth from mother or father. And he became an enemy of Indra. And he was so powerful that he defeated Indra, took over the heavenly planet. Indra was chased out of his kingdom. So being in that situation, the demigods have lost their place of residence. So they approached the Lord. That look, this is what this Chitraketu has, this Vritrasura has done to us. So please tell us, what should we do? Please do something about it. We are your appointed administrators in the universal affairs. We are your servants. We are your administrative executives. You are our Lord and Master. So please do something about this situation, that now that our rightful place of residence has been taken away by this demon. Then the Lord said, you go to this very, very exalted sage, and you ask him for his bones. His name is Dodhichi. You ask for his bone, and from his bone you create a weapon called Vajra. And this Vajra will be the only weapon that can kill Vritrasura. So Indra then went to Dodhichi Muni and told him, please, this is what has happened to us, and we need that, with the Lord said that from your bone only this weapon can be created with which Vritrasura can be killed. So will you please give us your bone? So another wonderful example of detachment. Dadichi said, after all, this body which is meant for the food for worms and insects at the end, if this body can be used for some divine purpose, for some valuable purpose, then let the body be used for that. Saying that, he left his body. With his bones, Indra created the Vajra. So the English translation of Vajra is thunder. Now, with thunder in hand, Indra went to confront Vritra. Already so many times Vritra had defeated Indra, that for him this challenge didn't really mean anything. So he confronted, but this time Vritra knew that this time Indra is coming with a very special weapon, which is actually had been designed to kill him. So he said, fine. And this time the demigods became so powerful that Vritra's soldiers, out of fear, ran out of the battlefield. And Vritra addressed them, that you are not the putras of your parents. You are the mutras of your parents. You are not the sons of your parents. You are the urine of your mother. Cowards. And alone, Vritrasura confronted Indra. With his mace, he struck Airavat, Indra's elephant, so hard on the head that Airavat retracted 10 steps backward. He went back like 10 steps. Indra fell out of the elephant. Vajra slipped out of his hand. And Indra was standing unarmed. At that time, Britra could have killed Indra. But Britra was not only an exalted devotee of the Lord, he was a valiant warrior. He didn't want to attack his unarmed enemy. So he said, Indra, this is not the time to become bewildered. This is not the time to become confused. You have appeared here with a mission to kill me. And I know this Vajra has been designed to kill me. So if that is the Lord's will, fine, I'll accept it. So just pick up that Vajra and fight. So then Indra picked up the Vajra and started to fight with Britra. With the Vajra, Indra cut Britrasura's right hand. Britra kept on fighting with his left hand. He cut his left hand. Britra kept on fighting with his legs. He cut his legs with the Vajra. Then Britra assumed a gigantic form and swallowed Indra up. And from inside his belly with the Vajra, Indra cut open his abdomen and came out. Then he applied the Vajra on his neck. And it took the Vajra 365 days to sever Britrasura's head from his body. And at the end of this chapter, it has been mentioned that it was not that Britra was killed. It was Indra who was killed. When Britrasura swallowed up Indra, he felt okay. Now the business is finished. I've killed him. And Britrasura left his body. And he went back to Shankarshan Loka, the abode of his master. So in the light of this episode, we see what a coward Indra was, and what a hero Britrasura was. Compared to Britrasura, Indra looked like a grossest sense gratifier. Completely shameless. Went to Radhichi, can you please give me a bone so that I can enjoy the heavenly planet? Whereas Britrasura's character, we can see, it shines forth like brilliant as the sun. So that is the glory of a devotee of the Lord. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Bol. Yes, no clapping. I told you all yesterday. So, does anybody have any question? Okay, Ananda, give him the mic. Okay, so in the meantime, I can answer these questions. So the first question is from Parmeshwari Radhika. डियर जय श्रील गुरुदेव, कोटि कोटि दंडवत प्रणाम। जय श्रील प्रभुपाद। गुरुदेव, माय क्वेश्चन इज, इन दिस मटेरियल वर्ल्ड व्हाट एवर डिस्टर्बेंसेस वी फेस आर ड्यू टू आवर कर्मा इन प्रीवियस लाइव्स, हाउ व्हाई डू वी फेस devotional obstacles? Do we face them because of our karma in previous lives? It may be, or it may not be, but a devotee's attitude is, whenever something good happens, he thinks it's the mercy due to Lord's mercy, and when something bad happens, he thinks it's due to my karma, right? Whereas in the material platform, whenever something good happens, he thinks it's my credit. And whenever something bad happens, why the Lord did it to me? Right? There is no Bhagavan. Agar Bhagavan hota, to aisa nahi kabhi hota. Right? So, our business is to take everything in the right perspective. When there is difficulties, when there is obstacles, then we devotees take it as, it's the Lord's test of my sincerity. So I'm not going to be perturbed by that. I'll just carry on with my spiritual life. So Ananda Krishna Prem, you got your mic?
Yes.
Okay.
Guru Maharaj, I'm still unclear on this concept of caste. You mentioned that, for example, in Mahabharata, the Pandavas discriminated against Karna because he was from a lower...
Pandavas didn't make a discrimination? What did the Pandavas do?
They discriminated against Karna.
Against Karna? Okay.
And also, I understood now that what you're saying about our national system, but I'm still not clear what it means to us to respond to that, about the concept of birth caste.
You see, the sound system here is, there is a lot of reverb, so I'm not hearing properly. Maybe lower the mic or hold it a little away from your mouth. Okay, now say it.
I'm still not clear about the concept of birth caste in our understanding. I'm not clear about our understanding of birth caste.
Caste system, you mean?
Birth caste.
That's what I mean, the caste system, yeah. The thing is that, I got your point. Just birth is not enough. Qualification is the main criteria. But birth used to help in those age. Alright, which doesn't happen nowadays. Right? The birth doesn't bear any significance to one's varna. Because one is not really, if one does not develop the characteristics, he will not become considered to be belong to that specific caste. Does it answer your question?
Yes.
Anyway, maybe it will be better you write out the questions. So I think it will be better to write the questions, that way it becomes easier for me to understand. For some reason, even Mukunda Hari was speaking, I was finding it difficult to, like, something, where the mics are? It's there, yeah? Okay. I mean the speakers. Okay, anyway, so you write it down. So this next question is from Debahuti. Dear Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances at your divine lotus feet. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to you. Question 1. It appears from the story of Ajamil that even accidental chanting of the Lord's name can relieve the most sinful man of all his sins, irrespective of his situation, he is a devotee. So does this imply that at the time of death, even a non-devotee can hope for rescue by unintentional chanting or hearing? What is the aftermath of such liberation? Good point. Like, yes, chanting will free one from sinful reactions, even if it is accidental. But I don't remember any mention about just hearing. Hearing must lead to acceptance, and the acceptance comes from chanting, right? And unconscious chanting or namabhash frees one from sinful reactions and awards liberation, right? But this liberation is not the favorable liberation of four kinds of mukti in Vaikuntha. This liberation is sajujya mukti, merging into Brahman, because the ultimate consideration is sambandha, relationship. Unless and until one develops relationship with Krishna, he cannot have the positive liberation that is in Vaikuntha. Right? So here we see Ajamil became free, but then he practiced devotional service and then he went to Vaikuntha. So in order to develop that kind of liberation, the ultimate liberation in Vaikuntha, one must develop his loving relationship with the Lord. Just freedom from sinful reactions is not enough. Therefore, when Krishna says, Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami, I'll deliver you from all your sinful reactions, but then he added, Ma suchaha. That is, just liberation or freedom from sinful reactions is not enough. You'll get something when you surrender unto me, you'll get something far superior to that. That is, by surrendering, you'll be free from your sinful reactions, but that surrender will lead to devotion. And that devotion, what will that devotion award is going to be far superior than liberation. Therefore, it is said, devotees don't worry about liberation. They're already liberated. Second question, it is bewildering how the stories of Srimad Bhagavatam in one hand depicts the achievability of devotion, whereas some other stories depict how even a minute imperfection can hold one back. How do we understand this? What makes you think that a minute imperfection may hold one back? Yeah, that is because he was not a devotee until then, right? But he got a chance now to become a devotee. And when he became a devotee, he's perfected his life. All right? Take the mic. Oh, it's better. I think I can hear you better. Bharat Maharaj, what he did is, Bharat Maharaj, it has to be understood that, see, Bharat Maharaj, You know, ultimately, it's all an example that the Lord is citing, right, through his devotees. And with Bharat Maharaj, it is said that getting the animal body, deer body, all his sinful reactions are burnt out. And then he got the body of a pure devotee. So Krishna is Krishna's arrangement. Like, it's not that we are so concerned about liberation. If it doesn't come in one lifetime, doesn't matter. We'll keep on coming, serving the Lord, life after life. Okay? Oh, another question is there. Okay. Quite a few questions today. Okay. Third question is, Guru Maharaj, is there any reason behind King Dasharath dividing the sweet rice between the queens in the said manner? Yeah. The reason means why first he divided it instead of giving it to just one queen? Okay. Because Kaushalya was the principal queen, right? And Kaikeyi was the youngest of the three. She was the one he got married last. And he was very attached to Kaikeyi. And that's why he gave that to one portion to Kaikeyi right after giving to Kaushalya. Then he gave one portion to Sumitra. So after Sumitra, giving it to Sumitra, one portion was still left. Therefore he gave it to Kaikeyi because she was so dear to him. And of course the ultimate consideration is, there are four of them. Chaturbuha. Vasudev, Shankarshan, Pradyumna, Aniruddha. So they had to come. Ramchandra is Vasudev, Shankarshan is Lakshman, and Pradyumna and Aniruddha are Bharat and Shatrughna. Okay, let me see. Nrisinghananda Das from South Africa. Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, please clarify the differences between Rudra and Lord Shiva who stays at Mount Kailash. Where do the 11 Rudras stay and do they only appear at the time of destruction? Your servant, Nrisinghananda. You see, these Rudras are incarnations of Lord Shiva. And incarnations and the original personality, actually there is no difference. But the incarnations come to accomplish certain purpose. So Rudra here is the destructive aspect which came out in the form of anger of Lord Brahma. So that is the difference. Whereas Lord Shiva in Mount Kailash is peaceful. And Rudra, Brahma actually told them to control their senses, control his senses. And he had 11 aspects. So this is how we have to see that Lord Shiva is the original personality of Lord Shiva and Rudra is his incarnation. And as an incarnation, Rudra is taking care of the destructive aspect. Just as Vishnu is the maintenance aspect. So this maintenance aspect requires killing the demons. Krishna doesn't kill demons. So when Krishna kills the demons, it is Vishnu in Krishna that kills the demons. Although it appears that Krishna is killing, but actually Krishna is not killing. Vishnu is killing those demons. So Marian from Leicester, Dandavat Pranam Guru Maharaj, Pamho AGTSP, please accept my obeisances at your lotus feet. I was told by a senior devotee that at initiation, our sins are burned away in the fire. If we are already chanting 16 rounds and only one name of the Lord frees us, why do we need the fire? Yeah. The general consideration is that if the chanting is offensive, then it won't derive the benefit. Pure chanting will give Krishna prem. Clearing chanting and clearing stage will give us freedom from all sinful reactions and liberation. But what is the guarantee that this chanting is happening in a pure stage or in a clearing stage? So there is this safeguard. If it is not, if it is offensive chanting, then it won't have the required results. Therefore, this process of initiation, process of surrender, and this surrender eventually leads to bhakti or devotion. So that is why the beginning of that formal life of devotional service is through this process of initiation. But if you have already attained the perfected stage, then you don't need to take initiation. Shailendra, Indore, dear Guru Maharaj, please accept my most humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. What was the mantra Narad Muni gave to Chitraketu? Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Generally, mantras are not broadcasted. Although in case of Dhruva Maharaj, Narad Muni gave the mantra, 12-syllable mantra, but in Bhagavatam, the mantra was not really announced. It was Srila Prabhupada who in the purport actually mentioned that that mantra was Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Now about Chitraketu, Prabhupada did not explicitly say what the mantra was, therefore I don't know. Because Bhagavatam doesn't say that. Ramananda Rai Das, Belgium. Question 1. Dear Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Thank you for the exciting class. Guru Maharaj, Ajamil chanted a few times the names of Narayan and he was saved. Why do we actually chant about 30,000 names and more every day? Because in order to achieve perfection, you chant the name. First of all, because becoming free from sinful reaction is not the goal. Our goal is, we are not chanting just to become free from sinful reaction. We are chanting the holy name of the Lord in order to achieve devotion to His lotus feet. And when we even achieve our perfection in devotional service, then also we keep on chanting the holy name of the Lord. So that is why as the means we chant the holy name, and also this holy name is the goal of our spiritual practice. The next question is, Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisance. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. How is it that the activities did not create karmic reactions if he went against the demigods? I think it's a question about Dhritarasura. How is it that the activities of Dhritarasura, which isn't mentioned here, did not create karmic reactions if he went against the demigods? Well, he went against demigods, that was his... and you can say that because he went against demigod, he died. One of the qualification or identity of Krishna is Indrari. Bakulang loke, he comes to take care of Indra's enemies. So because he became Indra's enemy, Krishna arrange for him to die. So it is not a karmic reaction as such, but it was Krishna's arrangement. And a devotee, because he acts on a transcendental platform, acting as an agent of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he is beyond karmic reactions. But still, until he achieves his perfection, some karmic reactions remain, and he becomes liable to those reactions, but those reactions are secondary. So, Srimati Radhika, Hyderabad. My dear Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances at your holy feet. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to your holiness. Guru Maharaj, I am very much thankful for your clear explanation. Half-digested food of great devotees' lives and their spirituality. Thank you also for taking the names of devotees and telling us how they are serving our movement. This is making a very much inspiring of past and present Vaishnava's activities. My question is, our consciousness taking us to goodness, is just chanting God's name enough with whatever level of faith? We hear also that people who leave their bodies in Jagannath Puri or Vrindavan are taken to Godhead. Please kindly clarify. Okay, so yeah, by leaving one's body in these dhams, one actually achieves inconceivable spiritual benefit. Just by leaving his body in Vrindavan or Jagannath Puri, as you mentioned, one may go back to Godhead, or one goes back to Godhead. But at the same time, we have to also consider that not that we can always leave our bodies in Vrindavan. Those who can leave their bodies in Vrindavan, we have to understand that they are very special souls. And those who are leaving their bodies in Jagannath Puri also is the same. Sometimes we have seen people lived in Vrindavan for their whole life, but at the time of death, they were taken out of Vrindavan, left their bodies out of Vrindavan. So these are all divine arrangement of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Okay, let me see how many questions we can cover. This is from Mitesh Das. You told about creation done by Brahma out of out of 8,400,000 species, only human being species you mentioned. So what about other species? Would you please tell us about the other animals, aquatics? They are described in the scriptures. So I will say everything is not possible to mention in this class. So you take the trouble of finding out from Srimad Bhagavatam. Giriraj Das, Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, Dandavat Pranam, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. My question is that we heard so many times that devotees' forefather get liberated due to a devotee being born in the family. On the other hand, we hear how Chitraketu's son, when he was brought back to life, he said, which father and which mother? How do we understand how our forefathers are related to us? Don't they take birth somewhere else? And all connections get severed. Well, they may not remember that you became a devotee, or you may not remember that where they are, but Krishna remembers and he makes the arrangements. When somebody becomes a devotee, Krishna feels indebted to him and benefits him in this way. Madhavendra Puri, thank you Guru Maharaj, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur mentioned that Britrasura is one of the greatest devotees in the Srimad Bhagavatam after the gopis, your servant. Yeah, Britrasura was a devotee. Like when Shankarshan came to him, he mentioned that you are my devotee from the past. So that way, and we can see how exalted he was. Like, look at his attitude. And what do we learn to do? Cultivate that attitude. Sarga apavargesu tullartha darshina. To him, going to heaven or suffering in hell is the same. How many of us are ready to go to hell if Krishna wants? But a pure devotee will say, if Krishna wants, okay, I'll go. I mean, there'll be so many souls to preach to. And they're more ripe than the people here in the age of Kali. Look, nobody wants to listen to me. But there everybody will be listening with rapt attention because they're suffering so much. And if I go and tell them that, look, this is the way to get out of your suffering condition, chant Hare Krishna, everyone will start chanting. Kanakabja, Kanchanabja Das. Where is Kanakabja? Okay. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to your divine grace. Lord Brahma was given the duty of creating many living entities for the universe. Did this coincide with so many jivas desiring independence when in the spiritual world? Yeah, the thing is, the spirit souls that look away from Krishna come to this world. All right? So those living entities are getting the bodies are already those who are meant to be here. So Brahma and the other Prajapatis and the Demi are giving bodies according to their karmic subtle body. Mehak from Indore. Hare Krishna, Dhanavad Pranam, Guru Maharaj, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. As you mentioned that Haridas Thakur said about the power of chanting of holy name, one holy name which can destroy all sins. Does it mean pure chanting? Also, Guru Maharaj, I had second. Okay. So, no, Haridas Thakur is saying Naam Abhash. Chanting in the clearing stage will deliver all sinful reaction, deliver one from all sinful reaction. And the pure chanting gives Krishna prem. Also, Guru Maharaj, I had second question that Prabhupada said, if one reads Bhagavatam daily, then as he reaches first to ninth canto, he becomes self-realized. But in my case, I used to feel why I am not becoming self-realized. What should be my attitude towards this situation? So when you become self-realized, you don't think that you become self-realized. That is the problem about the spiritual progress. Actually, the problem with the spiritual progress is that when you progress, you don't feel you're progressing. You feel as if you're regressing. For example, a neophyte devotee, that means one who is very new to Krishna consciousness. You know what his attitude is like? His attitude is, I am the only devotee. In the entire universe, I am the only devotee. Krishna is God and I am the only devotee. The qualification or the identity of a second class devotee is he sees the difference between Krishna, Krishna's devotees, innocent and offenders. He knows or he recognizes that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But he also recognizes Krishna's devotees. And for Krishna, he has love. For Krishna's devotees, he has friendship. For the innocent, he has compassion. And for the offenders, he has disregard. So that's the second class devotee. So first class devotee, a third class devotee doesn't recognize any devotee. In second class stage, he recognizes other devotees. And in the first class stage, you know what happens? He sees everybody is a devotee, only he couldn't become a devotee. So see the transition from I am the only devotee to I couldn't even become a devotee while everyone else is a devotee. The first one, I am the only devotee and no one is a devotee. And the pure stage of devotion, everyone else is a devotee, only I couldn't become a devotee. So, are you progressing or regressing? So if you think that nothing is happening to you, it's a good sign. If you're thinking that you couldn't become a pure devotee, I will say it's a very good sign. Ruchir, Tyagi, where is Ruchir? Okay. Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, Dandavat Pranam. Maharaj, you mentioned that it's not shuttle, it's subtle, S-U-B-T-L-E. Subtle body never dies. Then what happens to subtle body when one leaves for spiritual world? Yeah, very good. In order to go back to the spiritual world, we have to become free from the bondage of the body. Now, we do become free from the bondage of the gross body at the time of death. But as I mentioned, subtle body doesn't die. The body consisting of mind, intelligence and false ego, they don't die. But they can get transformed. They can get spiritualized. Right? So subtle body is there, consisting of mind, intelligence, false ego. But when the mind is engaged in thinking of Krishna, then it is spiritualized. In this way, when one becomes constantly engaged in serving Krishna, then Krishna gives him spiritual intelligence, which is known as devotional service or buddhi yoga. And in this way, when one becomes a servant of Krishna, his subtle body made of false ego is transformed into his real identity. So that stage, at that stage, there is no subtle body. It's a pure spirit soul. Pure spirit soul existing in the gross body. And that stage is called Jivan Mukta stage. And then when he leaves his gross body, then he goes back to Godhead. And that is called achieving spiritual perfection completely. Or it is called Bastu Siddhi. Jivan Mukta stage, or when the spirit soul, pure spirit soul is living in the body, it is called Swarup Siddhi. He is situated in his spiritual identity. Pure spiritual identity. And when he leaves his gross body, it's Bastu Siddhi. He goes back to the spiritual world with the spiritual body. No more gross body. Ananta Prem Das. Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. I have heard from a devotee that when one is chanting the holy name, Maya is running away. So far I know it is very difficult to get rid of Maya. Then how is it possible that Maya is running away when chanting the holy name? Well, Maya may run away, but if you run after Maya, Then who can help you? Gopangana Devi Dasi. Gopangana. Okay. She wrote in Hindi, Param Pujaniya Sri Guru Maharaj ke Sri Charano mein Koti Koti Dandavat Pranam. Param Pujaniya Sri Prabhupad ko bhi main Koti Koti Dandavat Pranam. Guru Maharaj, hum sabhi param saubhagyashali hain कि आपकी इतनी मधुर अमृतमय वाणी सुनने का सुअवसर प्राप्त हुआ. मेरा प्रश्न ये है कि हम सभी भी भगवान को ही चरणों में पूर्णतः शरणागत कैसे होंगे? क्या हमको श्री जड़भरत महाराज के जैसे बनने का प्रयास करना चाहिए? जड़भर जैसे बनने का प्रयास करना चाहिए, क्या उससे हम पूर्णतः शरणागत हो सकते हैं? सो द क्वेश्चन इज दैट वी आर वेरी फॉर्चुनेट दैट वी आर लिसनिंग टू, वी हैव गॉट दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू लिसन टू दिस डिस्कोर्स फ्रॉम यू. माय क्वेश्चन इज how can we become fully surrendered to the lotus feet of the Lord? Do we have to become like Jarabharat, or do we have to behave like Jarabharat? That's your question. वैसे तुम्हारा ये प्रश्न है, जड़ भरत जैसे हमको आचरण करना होगा? हाँ, वैसे गुंगा जड़ बनना होगा? अगर हो सकता है तो बहुत अच्छा है. बल्कि अगर लोग समझ लेंगे कि तुम एक्टिंग कर रहे हो तब मुश्किल हो जाएगा. Nayanabhiram, okay, you're sitting there. Guru, Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Guru Maharaj, you mentioned that the subtle body never dies. As I've understood, the subtle body consists of mind, intelligence, false ego. The question is, when you return to... Anyway, this has been answered, right? You got the answer. So this is no name.
I'm sorry, I forgot to write my name.
Okay. Okay, dear Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisance. All glories. You have mentioned that the subtle body never dies. Now the gross and subtle body both being material, what happens to the subtle body when the soul goes back home to Godhead? Got the answer. How can, second question, how can the Vishnu Dutas appear in regards to one name of the Lord which was uttered unconsciously? Why the cause for their appearance was not due to maybe way more names he had chanted previously, which might have been filled with much more devotion? Does it mean that only the chanting of the at the moment of death is the ultimate consideration in relation to one's next destination? So first of all, I don't know whether Jarabara chanted the holy name before, right? He acted like a Brahmana, but there was no mention of his chanting the holy name. As you said, whether the Vishnu Dutas came for his previous chanting. So that is the thing. And the second consideration is, here it has been very clearly mentioned He called out to his son, and that chanting brought the Vishnudutas because it was chanted in a Naam Abhash stage. Okay, thank you all very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, Gaur Premanande, Hari Hari.